Welcome to BioBalance HealthCast. I'm Dr. Kathy Maupin. They call me the Hormone Queen.
Well, I'm Brett Newcomb, and I'm not any kind of queen.
Fortunately.
Well, we are continuing our conversation in this podcast that we began in the last podcast about the hormone progesterone and the theories around the replacement of that, and particularly referencing the issue of PMS. And in the last podcast, we talked about PMS and the cultural myths that surround it and why they're myths. Today, we're going to continue that conversation. We're going to begin by talking about stress and natural adaptations to stress. In the previous podcast, we were discussing that anthropologists have known for a long time that in primitive cultures, especially nomadic hunter-gatherer societies, when food supplies diminish, when there's a drought or when the animals move on and they can't find enough protein to support the tribe, that women stop having menstrual cycles, they stop getting pregnant, they stop having babies. And that has been known forever, but we haven't known the science of it. We've just known the theory and the reality. The evidence is that this happens. And then when they get to a place where food supplies become more abundant, they start having periods again, they start getting pregnant again, and you have clusters of children that are all the same age because they follow the food cycle. And Kathy was explaining in the previous episode that they don't just follow the food cycle, they follow the hormone cycle of the women. And this is connected because of the natural way the body works. And so if you'll go back and review that for a minute, and particularly in terms of what we call PMS, then we can talk about it.
When we're stressed or when we're starving, those are stresses.
Yeah, stresses me out.
Women stop making progesterone first. And when we stop making progesterone, the hormone that is secreted from day 14 through 28, then we are no longer fertile. Okay, so it takes away our fertility. It also takes away the stability that progesterone gives us. It gives us mental stability. It works on our neurotransmitters. Mm-hmm. It is the inciting incident of depression and anxiety when we don't have any. So it normally stabilizes our brain. Okay. So it does work neurologically. It's just not it's the first thing that makes the neurotransmitters imbalanced when we don't have enough progesterone. So anybody at any age can have PMS unless they're premenstrual or they're menopausal. You don't have PMS then because you don't have cycles. When you don't have cycles, it doesn't affect you in the same way.
So if you're too young and too old,
right,
it's not an issue.
You're not going to have PMS. And you're not going to require progesterone, because there's a lot of people that think you should have progesterone your whole lives. They're giving progesterone to men. Men never have progesterone. There's just no reason for that. And I don't understand
the theory. I don't remember the last time I was pregnant.
I know. And you guys don't make it. So, yeah. I mean, why would I give it to you?
Right.
It's really not that great for guys. So I can tell you that is not what you want to do. And there's only a few people in my population of menopausal women who require progesterone, and those are people with uteruses, and it's only to protect their uterus from estrogen, to keep it balanced, just like it does before we're menopausal. And the second kind, there's a few people who just psychologically they need that to boost their neurotransmitters. So instead of giving them antidepressants or anti-anxiety agents, I give them progesterone. Mm-hmm. And so even if they have no uterus, I'll do that, and I can figure that out not by labs but by symptoms.
So when you give somebody progesterone, there are, as in all of the hormone replacement issues, there are different methodologies of delivery.
Yes.
And you were explaining in the previous podcast that you first began to do this with a rectal suppository.
Yes.
And that you don't use that as the preferred method anymore.
Right.
But the science has evolved through rectal to oral to pellets, I'm assuming.
Well, not oral.
Okay.
Well, we don't have, that's why I chose rectal or anything besides oral in the beginning. Because you can take bioidentical progesterone, and if you take it orally, it becomes estrogen in the liver before it ever gets out to your body. So it's doing the wrong thing. It's doing the opposite of what progesterone does.
Because progesterone balances the estrogen in the uterus.
And
if it just turns into, and in the brain, and if it just turns into estrogen,
you just got more of the same problem.
You've accelerated the problem.
Okay. Right. So if your doctor gives you, oh, it's bioidentical, here, take this pill, that's not going to work. Uh-huh. So bioidentical doesn't mean anything if it's oral. But if you take a progestin, which is a synthesized progesterone, that also makes you worse because it makes a lot of estrogens, estrone, estradiol, all kinds of estrogens that make you feel worse. So progestins like Provera and Agestin don't work.
So if you feel bad now and you take this, you feel really bad.
That's right. You will. I mean, it may put you over the edge. So that's not the way to do it. You have to do something that is not oral. So now we've graduated to vaginal suppositories. Then we went to vaginal tabs, like little ready tabs that dissolve. You know, they dissolve quickly. So we use them in the vagina, or you can put those same tabs that are flavored under the tongue and they dissolve. Mm-hmm. And that goes directly into your bloodstream instead of into your liver. So that's why we use the things we do. We even use progesterone cream, but creams you have to apply 6 times a day to get a really good blood dose. They don't last very long.
I'm hesitating because I'm not sure I understand what you just said. You said it goes directly into the bloodstream and not to the liver.
It goes to the liver after it's been working.
Okay.
So it does eventually go to the liver.
Okay.
But you get a delivery to your body.
First.
It works.
Yeah.
It gets transformed a little bit. Then it goes to your liver and it doesn't cause the estrogen.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's already been broken down somewhat by being used. Mm-hmm. So that's how that works. Mm-hmm. But when you look at different types of progesterone, you have to think about how it's delivered, because delivery matters, and the absorption matters, but it also matters how many times you take it. If you use a vaginal tab, you can take it once a day. If you use a sublingual tab, if it's compounded properly, you can use it once a day. If you use anything else like a cream or a gel, you're going to have to apply it all day long. Okay. Now, as I said, progesterone makes you tired, so you don't want to apply it all day long. You want to take it once at night.
Mm-hmm.
So the goal is non-oral, bioidentical, and a delivery system that you just take once at night to keep your system even. Otherwise, you're going up and down all day. So that's not good for our brains either. So having an even delivery system is good. So pellets are available in progesterone, and I like using those because you don't have to think about them but every 4 months, and that's in menopausal women. But in premenopausal women, we don't usually use those because we want to cycle you.
Mm-hmm. So, if you do this and you restore the balance for women who are fertile and who have cycles, and that solves a lot of those mood issues.
It also makes them fertile.
And increases their fertility.
Yeah.
So what happens then when they go through menopause? Do you continue to give them progesterone?
Well, when they go through menopause and I'm replacing their estrogen, if they have a uterus, I give them progesterone.
Why?
Because estrogen stimulates the uterus to make a very thick lining, and it'll just grow thicker and thicker and thicker unless you have progesterone. So we give low-dose estrogen so it doesn't get too thick, and then we give progesterone with it so that the lining is stable and doesn't grow very high. If it grows high, it becomes cancerous.
That's what I was going to ask. But why would it matter if you weren't having pregnancies if your lining is thicker and thicker?
Well, if it's thicker and thicker, it can become cancer. But if it's thicker and thicker, eventually it's going to be so thick it's just going to bleed and heavy.
Okay.
So when you don't have progesterone balancing out that lining, you'd have to see a pathology to book. It makes it go from real fluffy and thick to real compact and sturdy.
Streamlined.
You know, you can see it just by looking at the pictures. And it keeps it from being destabilized and bleeding. It doesn't turn into cancer if you have progesterone. Progesterone is not necessarily necessary to keep you from getting breast cancer, but it is for uterine cancer. So if you don't have a uterus, I don't give progesterone to patients who are menopausal. They don't need it because they're getting estrogen. And in general, the small population that does need it, I give them that. But I only know that after I've given them estrogen, testosterone made them normal there. And they just still feel a little irritable. They can't sleep or they just don't feel like themselves.
So it still has to be fine-tuned. It's not one-size-fits-all medicine. This is not a panacea. Oh, take this pill or don't take this pill.
This is the most difficult thing I've ever done.
Uh-huh.
It's individualizing treatment for every person that sits in front of me. And you should know all these things, but you have to know someone to help you interpret it for you. Because I also look at blood work, and I also look at history and what you tell me. So I have to put all that together into a treatment plan. Then we try it, just like it's a practice of medicine. You know, we have to try it, and then your metabolism might be a little different, so then we have to tweak it. But once we get your dose after menopause, it's your dose.
Well, you know, I'm sitting here listening to all that you're saying, and I'm thinking about the years of practice in counseling and psychotherapy that I did. And when I was in school, I was taught that women get depressed six times more often, or diagnosed with depression six times more often than men.
They go to the doctors, though.
Well,
no. To get diagnosed.
Well, the way that it was explained to us is that men become drunks. You know, they self-medicate with alcohol in ways that
women
didn't.
They put their hand through the wall.
Yeah.
That, you know.
But they developed all of these pills for depression and mood disorders. And in working with men, in my experience, are chronically resistant to that because there's this cultural myth that you have to tough it out. You know, John Wayne wouldn't take medicine sort of thing. And it's characterological, that if I have a strong character and I discipline myself, then I don't need pills and I'll just fight through this. And frequently they would give the same messages to their daughters and to their wives, and yet loop back around to the myth that says, women are emotionally unstable, what are you going to do? They're always going to be depressed or hyper or volatile. And what you're explaining is that there is medicine.
For women, there's a reason.
Well, and there's a medicine, a treatment that doesn't involve mood disorder medicines.
Right.
I mean, that's a the skies are opening kind of message for me, that I'm not aware that in my field that message is out there.
Probably isn't, because it's not mainstream medicine yet. We got to wait 10 more years.
Not in mainstream medicine, not in mainstream psychology.
But women know, because we have this we have kind of like an underground, which is what we're supplying the underground with information today, because we know that there are people who understand this, and we know that they're not going to be at the lecture series by the medical societies,
right?
Because they're not accepted because they're so far ahead of their time.
So spread the word.
And
spread the word in these podcasts, and you're spreading the word in the book that you're writing. Yeah. This is the impetus for this conversation is actually a chapter in the book that you're writing.
I want what she's having.
Yeah.
So that's what it's titled.
Look for it in bookstores everywhere, but not yet.
Not quite.
So if you have questions, comments, feedback that you would like to share with us regarding this topic or any of the topics that are on our podcast, you can reach us directly
at my website at biobalancehealth.com, or you can email us at podcast@biobalancehealth.com, or you can call my office at 314-993-0963.
Or you can reach me directly at my blog, which is brettnewcomb.com.